Autobiography of Andrew Carnegie by Andrew Carnegie. Chapter 1. Parents and Childhood. If the story of any man's life, truly told, must be interesting, as some sage avers, those of my relatives and immediate friends who have insisted upon having an account of mine may not be unduly disappointed with this result. I may console myself with the assurance that such a story must interest at least a certain number of people who have known me, and that knowledge will encourage me to proceed. A book of this kind, written years ago by my friend Judge Mellon of Pittsburgh, gave me so much pleasure that I am inclined to agree with the wise one whose opinion I have given above. For, certainly, the story which the judge told has proved a source of infinite satisfaction to his friends, and must continue to influence succeeding generations of his family to live life well. And not only this, to some beyond his immediate circle it holds rank with their favorite authors. The book contains one essential feature of value. It reveals the man. It was written without any intention of attracting public notice, being designed only for his family. In like manner, I intend to tell my story, not as one posturing before the public, but as in the midst of my own people and friends, tried and true, to whom I can speak with some utmost freedom, feeling that even trifling incidents may not be wholly destitute of interest for them. To begin, then, I was born in Dunfermline, in the attic of the small one-story house, corner of Moody Street and Priory Lane, on the 25th of November, 1835. And, as the saying is, of poor but honest parents, of good kith and kin. Dunfermline had long been noted as the center of the damask trade in Scotland. My father, William Carnegie, was a damask weaver, the son of Andrew Carnegie, after whom I was named. My grandfather Carnegie was well known throughout the district for his wit and humor, his genial nature and irrepressible spirits. He was head of the lively ones of his day, and known far and near as the chief of their joyous club, Pettymuir College. Upon my return to Dunfermline, after an absence of 14 years, I remember being approached by an old man who had been told that I was the grandson of the professor, my grandfather's title among his cronies. He was the very picture of palsied eld. His nose and chin they threatened ither. As he tottered across the room toward me, and laid his trembling hand upon my head, he said, "And ye are the grandson o' Andrew Carnegie, eh, mon? I ha' seen the day when your grandfather and I could ha' hallooed ony reasonable man out o' his jidgment." Several other old people of Dunfermline told me stories of my grandfather. Here is one of them. One Hogmanay night, an old whiffy, quite a character in the village, being surprised by a disguised face suddenly thrust in at the window, looked up and after a moment's pause exclaimed, "Oh, it's just that daft callant Andrew Carnegie." She was right. My grandfather, at 75, was out frightening his old lady friends, disguised like other frolicking youngsters. I think my optimistic nature, my ability to shed trouble and to laugh through life, making all my ducks swans, as friends say I do, must have been inherited from this delightful old masquerading grandfather, whose name I am proud to bear. A sunny disposition is worth more than fortune. Young people should know that it can be cultivated, that the mind, like the body, can be moved from the shade into sunshine. Let us move it, then. Laugh trouble away, if possible, and one usually can, if he be anything of a philosopher, provided that self-reproach comes not from his own wrongdoing. That always remains. There is no washing out of these damned spots. The judge within sits in the Supreme Court and can never be cheated. Hence, the grand rule of life which Burns gives, "Thine own reproach alone do fear." This motto, adopted early in life, has been more to me than all the sermons I ever heard. And I have heard not a few, although I may admit resemblance to my old friend Bailey Walker in my mature years. He was asked by his doctor about his sleep, and replied that it was far from satisfactory. He was very wakeful, adding, with a twinkle in his eye, "But I get a bit fine doze in the kirk noo and then." On my mother's side, the grandfather was even more marked, for my grandfather, Thomas Morrison, was a friend of William Cobbett, a contributor to his Register, and in constant correspondence with him. Even as I write, in Dunfermline, old men who knew Grandfather Morrison speak of him as one of the finest orators and ablest men they have known. He was publisher of The Precursor, a small edition, it might be said, of Cobbett's Register, and thought to have been the first radical paper in Scotland. I have read some of his writings, and in view of the importance now given to technical education, I think the most remarkable of them is a pamphlet which he published 70-odd years ago, entitled Head Ecation versus Hand Ecation. It insists upon the importance of the latter in a manner that would reflect credit upon the strongest advocate of technical education today. It ends with these words: I thank God that in my youth I learned to make and mend shoes. Cobbett published it in the Register in 1833, remarking editorially, one of the most valuable communications ever published in the Register upon the subject is that of our esteemed friend and correspondent in Scotland, Thomas Morrison, which appears in this issue. So it seems I come by my scribbling propensities by inheritance, from both sides, for the Carnegies were also readers and thinkers. My grandfather Morrison was a born orator, a keen politician, and the head of the advanced wing of the Radical Party in the district, a position which his son, my uncle Bailey Morrison, occupied as his successor. More than one well-known Scotsman in America has called upon me to shake hands with the grandson of Thomas Morrison. Mr. Farmer, president of the Cleveland and Pittsburgh Railroad Company, once said to me, I owe all that I have of learning and culture to the influence of your grandfather. And Ebenezer Henderson, author of the remarkable history of Dunfermline, stated that he largely owed his advancement in life to the fortunate fact that while a boy he entered my grandfather's service. I have not passed so far through life without receiving some compliments, but I think nothing of a complimentary character has ever pleased me so much as this from a writer in a Glasgow newspaper who had been a listener to a speech on Home Rule in America which I delivered in St. Andrew's Hall. The correspondent wrote that much was then being said in Scotland with regard to myself and family, and especially my grandfather, Thomas Morrison, and he went on to say, judge my surprise when I found in the grandson on the platform, in manner, gesture, and appearance, a perfect facsimile of the Thomas Morrison of old. My surprising likeness to my grandfather, whom I do not remember to have ever seen, cannot be doubted, because I remember well upon my first return to Dunfermline in my 27th year, while sitting upon a sofa with my uncle Bailey Morrison, that his big black eyes filled with tears. He could not speak, and rushed out of the room overcome. Returning after a time, he explained that something in me now and then flashed before him, his father, who would instantly vanish, but come back at intervals. Some gesture it was, but what precisely he could not make out. My mother continually noticed in me some of my grandfather's peculiarities. The doctrine of inherited tendencies is proved every day and hour, but how subtle is the law which transmits gesture, something, as it were, beyond the material body. I was deeply impressed. My grandfather Morrison married Miss Hodge of Edinburgh, a lady in education, manners, and position, who died while the family was still young. At this time he was in good circumstances, a leather merchant conducting the tanning business in Dunfermline. But the peace after the Battle of Waterloo involved him in ruin, as it did thousands, so that while my uncle Bailey, the eldest son, had been brought up in what might be termed luxury, for he had a pony to ride, the younger members of the family encountered other and harder days. The second daughter, Margaret, was my mother, about whom I cannot trust myself to speak at length. She inherited from her mother the dignity, refinement, and air of the cultivated lady. Perhaps some day I may be able to tell the world something of this heroine, but I doubt it. I feel her to be sacred to myself and not for others to know. None could ever really know her. I alone did that. After my father's early death, she was all my own. The dedication of my first book tells the story. It was to my favorite heroine, my mother. Fortunate in my ancestors, I was supremely so in my birthplace. where one is born is very important, for different surroundings and traditions appeal to and stimulate different latent tendencies in the child. Ruskin truly observes that every bright boy in Edinburgh is influenced by the sight of the castle. So is the child of Dunfermline, by its noble abbey, the Westminster of Scotland, founded early in the 11th century, 1070, by Malcolm Canmore and his Queen Margaret, Scotland's patron saint. The ruins of the great monastery and of the palace where kings were born still stand, and there too is Pittencrieff Glen, embracing Queen Margaret's shrine and the ruins of King Malcolm's tower, with which the old ballad of Sir Patrick Spence begins. The king sits in Dunfermline Tower, drinking the blued red wine. The tomb of the Bruce is in the center of the abbey. St. Margaret's tomb is near, and many of the royal folk lie sleeping close around. Fortunate, indeed, the child who first sees the light in that romantic town, which occupies high ground 3 miles north of the Firth of Forth, overlooking the sea, with Edinburgh in sight to the south, and to the north, the peaks of the Ochils clearly in view. All is still redolent of the mighty past, when Dunfermline was both nationally and religiously the capital of Scotland. The child, privileged to develop amid such surroundings, absorbs poetry and romance with the air he breathes, assimilates history and tradition as he gazes around. These become to him his real world in childhood. The ideal is the ever-present real. The actual has yet to come when, later in life, he is launched into the workaday world of stern reality. Even then, until his last day, the early impressions remain, sometimes for short seasons disappearing perchance, but only apparently driven away or suppressed. They are always rising and coming again to the front to exert their influence, to elevate his thought and color his life. No bright child of Dunfermline can escape the influence of the abbey, palace, and glen. These touch him and set fire to the latent spark within, making him something different and beyond what, less happily born, he would have become. Under these inspiring conditions, my parents had also been born, and hence came, I doubt not, the potency of the romantic and poetic strain which pervaded both. As my father succeeded in the weaving business, we removed from Moody Street to a much more commodious house in Reed's Park. My father's 4 or 5 looms occupy the lower story. We resided in the upper, which was reached, after a fashion common in the older Scottish houses, by outside stairs from the pavement. It is here that my earliest recollections begin, and, strangely enough, the first trace of memory takes me back to a day when I saw a small map of America. It was upon rollers, and about 2 feet square. Upon this, my father, mother, Uncle William, and Aunt Aitken were looking for Pittsburgh, and pointing out Lake Erie and Niagara. Soon after, my uncle and Aunt Aitken sailed for the land of promise. At this time, I remember my cousin brother, George Lauder, Dodd, and myself were deeply impressed with the great danger overhanging us, because a lawless flag was secreted in the garret. It had been painted to be carried, and, I believe, was carried by my father, or uncle, or some other good radical of our family, in a procession during the Corn Law agitation. There had been riots in the town, and a troop of cavalry was quartered in the Guild Hall. My grandfathers and uncles on both sides, and my father, had been foremost in addressing meetings, and the whole family circle was in a ferment. I remember, as if it were yesterday, being awakened during the night by a tap at the back window by men who had come to inform my parents that my uncle, Bailey Morrison, had been thrown into jail because he had dared to hold a meeting which had been forbidden. The sheriff, with the aid of the soldiers, had arrested him a few miles from the town where the meeting had been held, and brought him into the town during the night, followed by an immense throng of people. Serious trouble was feared, for the populace threatened to rescue him, and, as we learned afterwards, he had been induced by the provost of the town to step forward to a window overlooking the high street and beg the people to retire. This he did, saying, "If there be a friend of the good cause here tonight, let him fold his arms." They did so, and then, after a pause, he said, "Now depart in peace." My uncle, like all our family, was a moral force man, and strong for obedience to law, but radical to the core and an intense admirer of the American Republic. One may imagine when all this was going on in public how bitter were the words that passed from one to the other in private. The denunciations of monarchical and aristocratic government, of privilege in all its forms, the grandeur of the republican system, the superiority of America, a land peopled by our own race, a home for freemen in which every citizen's privilege was every man's right. These were the exciting themes upon which I was nurtured. As a child, I could have slain king, duke, or lord, and considered this a service to the state, and hence an heroic act. Such is the influence of childhood's earliest associations that it was long before I could trust myself to speak respectfully of any privileged class or person who had not distinguished himself in some good way, and therefore earned the right to public respect. There was still the sneer behind for mere pedigree. He is nothing, has done nothing, only an accident, a fraud strutting in borrowed plumes. All he has to his account is the accident of birth. The most fruitful part of his family, as with the potato, lies underground. I wondered that intelligent men could live where another human being was born to a privilege which was not also their birthright. I was never tired of quoting the only words which gave proper vent to my indignation. There was a Brutus once that would have brooked the eternal devil to keep his state in Rome as easily as a king. But then kings were kings, not mere shadows. All this was inherited, of course. I only echoed what I heard at home. Dunfermline has long been renowned as perhaps the most radical town in the kingdom, although I know Paisley has claims. This is all the more creditable to the cause of radicalism, because in the days of which I speak, the population of Dunfermline was in large part composed of men who were small manufacturers, each owning his own loom or looms. They were not tied down to regular hours, their labors being piecework. They got webs from the larger manufacturers, and the weaving was done at home. These were times of intense political excitement, and there was frequently seen throughout the entire town, for a short time after the midday meal, small groups of men with their aprons girt about them discussing affairs of state. The names of Hume, Cobden, and Bright were upon everyone's tongue. I was often attracted, small as I was, to these circles, and was an earnest listener to the conversation, which was wholly one-sided. The generally accepted conclusion was that there must be a change. Clubs were formed among the townsfolk, and the London newspapers were subscribed for. The leading editorials were read every evening to the people, strangely enough, from one of the pulpits of the town. My uncle, Bailey Morrison, was often the reader, and, as the articles were commented upon by him and others after being read, the meetings were quite exciting. These political meetings were a frequent occurrence, and, as might be expected, I was as deeply interested as any of the family and attended many. One of my uncles, or my father, was generally to be heard. I remember one evening my father addressed a large outdoor meeting in the pens. I had wedged my way in under the legs of the hearers, and at one cheer, louder than all the rest, I could not restrain my enthusiasm. Looking up to the man under whose legs I had found protection, I informed him that was my father speaking. He lifted me on his shoulder and kept me there. To another meeting, I was taken by my father to hear John Bright, who spoke in favor of J.B. Smith as the Liberal candidate for the Stirling Burghs. I made the criticism at home that Mr. Bright did not speak correctly, as he said men when he meant man. He did not give the broad A we were accustomed to in Scotland. It is not to be wondered at that, nursed amid such surroundings, I developed into a violent young Republican whose motto was death to privilege. At that time, I did not know what privilege meant, but my father did. One of my Uncle Lauder's best stories was about this same J.B. Smith, the friend of John Bright, who was standing for Parliament in Dunfermline. Uncle was a member of his committee, and all went well until it was proclaimed that Smith was a Unitarian. The district was placarded with the inquiry, "Would you vote for a Unitarian?" It was serious. The chairman of Smith's committee in the village of Kearney Hill, a blacksmith, was reported as having declared he never would. Uncle drove over to remonstrate with him. They met in the village tavern over a gill.
"Man, I cannot vote for a Unitarian," said the chairman.
"But," said my uncle, "Maitland, the opposite candidate, is a Trinitarian."
"Damn, that's war," was the response.
And the blacksmith voted right. Smith won by a small majority. The change from hand loom to steam loom weaving was disastrous to our family. My father did not recognize the impending revolution and was struggling under the old system. His looms sank greatly in value, and it became necessary for that power which never failed in an emergency, my mother, to step forward and endeavor to repair the family fortune. She opened a small shop in Moody Street, and contributed to the revenues which, though slender, nevertheless at that time sufficed to keep us in comfort and respectable. I remember that shortly after this I began to learn what poverty meant. Dreadful days came when my father took the last of his webs to the great manufacturer, and I saw my mother anxiously awaiting his return to know whether a new web was to be obtained or that a period of idleness was upon us. It was burnt into my heart then that my father, though neither abject, mean, nor vile, as Burns has it, had nevertheless to beg a brother of the earth to give him leave to toil. And then and there came the resolve that I would cure that when I got to be a man. We were not, however, reduced to anything like poverty compared with many of our neighbors. I do not know to what lengths of privation my mother would not have gone that she might see her two boys wearing large white collars and trimly dressed. In an incautious moment, my parents had promised that I should never be sent to school until I asked leave to go. This promise, I afterward learned, began to give them considerable uneasiness because, as I grew up, I showed no disposition to ask. The schoolmaster, Mr. Robert Martin, was applied to and induced to take some notice of me. He took me upon an excursion one day with some of my companions who attended school, and great relief was experienced by my parents when one day, soon afterward, I came and asked for permission to go to Mr. Martin's school. I need not say the permission was duly granted. I had then entered upon my 8th year, which subsequent experience leads me to say is quite early enough for any child to begin attending school. The school was a perfect delight to me, and if anything occurred which prevented my attendance, I was unhappy. This happened every now and then, because my morning duty was to bring water from the well at the head of Moody Street. The supply was scanty and irregular. Sometimes it was not allowed to run until late in the morning, and a score of old wives were sitting around, the turn of each having been previously secured through the night by placing a worthless can in the line. This, as might be expected, led to numerous contentions in which I would not be put down even by these venerable old dames. I earned the reputation of being an awful laddie. In this way, I probably developed the strain of argumentativeness, or perhaps combativeness, which has always remained with me. In the performance of these duties, I was often late for school, but the master, knowing the cause, forgave the lapses. In the same connection, I may mention that I had often the shop errands to run after school, so that in looking back upon my life, I have the satisfaction of feeling that I became useful to my parents even at the early age of 10. Soon after that, the accounts of the various people who dealt with the shop were entrusted to my keeping, so that I became acquainted, in a small way, with business affairs even in childhood. One cause of misery there was, however, in my school experience. The boys nicknamed me Martin's Pet, and sometimes called out that dreadful epithet to me as I passed along the street. I did not know all that it meant, but it seemed to me a term of the utmost opprobrium, and I know that it kept me from responding as freely as I should otherwise have done to that excellent teacher, my only schoolmaster, to whom I owe a debt of gratitude, which I regret I never had opportunity to do more than acknowledge before he died. I may mention here a man whose influence over me cannot be overestimated, my uncle Lauder, George Lauder's father. My father was necessarily constantly at work in the loom shop and had little leisure to bestow upon me through the day. My uncle, being a shopkeeper in the High Street, was not thus tied down.
Note the location, for this was among the shopkeeping aristocracy, and high and varied degrees of aristocracy there were even among shopkeepers in Dunfermline. Deeply affected by my Aunt Seton's death, which occurred about the beginning of my school life, he found his chief solace in the companionship of his only son, George, and myself. He possessed an extraordinary gift of dealing with children, and taught us many things. Among others, I remember how he taught us British history by imagining each of the monarchs in a certain place upon the walls of the room performing the act for which he was well known. Thus, for me, King John sits to this day above the mantelpiece, signing the Magna Carta, and Queen Victoria is on the back of the door, with her children on her knee. It may be taken for granted that the omission which, years later, I found in the chapter house at Westminster Abbey was fully supplied in our list of monarchs. A slab in a small chapel at Westminster says that the body of Oliver Cromwell was removed from there. In the list of the monarchs which I learned at my uncle's knee, the Grand Republican Monarch appeared writing his message to the Pope of Rome, informing His Holiness that if he did not cease persecuting the Protestants, the thunder of Great Britain's cannon would be heard in the Vatican. It is needless to say that the estimate we formed of Cromwell was that he was worth them the gither. It was from my uncle I learned all that I know of the early history of Scotland, of Wallace and Bruce and Burns, of Blind Harry's history, of Scott, Ramsay, Tannehill, Hogg, and Ferguson. I can truly say, in the words of Burns, that there was then and there created in me a vein of Scottish prejudice, or patriotism, which will cease to exist only with life. Wallace, of course, was our hero. Everything heroic centered in him. Sad was the day when a wicked big boy at school told me that England was far larger than Scotland. I went to the uncle who had the remedy. "Not at all, Neg. If Scotland were rolled out flat as England, Scotland would be the larger. But would you have the Highlands rolled down?" "Oh, never. There was balm in Gilead for the wounded young patriot. Later, the greater population of England was forced upon me, and again to the uncle I went. "Yes, Neg, 7-1, but there were more than that odds against us at Bannockburn." And again there was joy in my heart, joy that there were more Englishmen there since the glory was the greater. This is something of a commentary upon the truth that war breeds war, that every battle sows the seeds of future battles, and that thus nations become traditional enemies. The experience of American boys is that of the Scotch. They grow up to read of Washington and Valley Forge, of Hessians hired to kill Americans, and they come to hate the very name of Englishman. Such was my experience with my American nephews. Scotland was all right, but England that had fought Scotland was the wicked partner. Not till they became men was the prejudice eradicated, and even yet some of it may linger. Uncle Lauder has told me since that he often brought people into the room assuring them that he could make Dodd, George Lauder, and me weep, laugh, or close our little fists ready to fight, in short, play upon all our moods through the influence of poetry and song. The betrayal of Wallace was his trump card, which never failed to cause our little hearts to sob, a complete breakdown being the invariable result. Often, as he told the story, it never lost its hold. No doubt it received from time to time new embellishments. My uncle's stories never wanted the hat and the stick which Scott gave his. How wonderful is the influence of a hero upon children! I spent many hours and evenings in the High Street with my uncle and Dodd, and thus began a lifelong brotherly alliance between the latter and myself. Dodd and Neg, we always were in the family. I could not say George in infancy, and he could not get more than Neg out of Carnegie, and it has always been Dodd and Neg with us. No other names would mean anything. There were two roads by which to return from my uncle's house in the High Street to my house in Moody Street at the foot of the town, one along the eerie churchyard of the Abbey among the dead, where there was no light, and the other along the lighted streets by way of the Maygate. When it became necessary for me to go home, my uncle, with a wicked pleasure, would ask which way I was going. Thinking what Wallace would do, I always replied I was going by the Abbey.
I have the satisfaction of believing that never, not even upon one occasion, did I yield to the temptation to take the other turn and follow the lamps at the junction of the May Gate. I often passed along that churchyard and through the dark arch of the abbey with my heart in my mouth, trying to whistle and keep up my courage. I would plod through the darkness, falling back in all emergencies upon the thought of what Wallace would have done if he had met with any foe, natural or supernatural. King Robert the Bruce never got justice from my cousin or myself in childhood. It was enough for us that he was a king while Wallace was the man of the people. Sir John Graham was our second. The intensity of a Scottish boy's patriotism, reared as I was, constitutes a real force in his life to the very end. If the source of my stock of that prime article, courage, were studied, I am sure the final analysis would find it founded upon Wallace, the hero of Scotland. It is a tower of strength for a boy to have a hero. It gave me a pang to find, when I reached America, that there was any other country which pretended to have anything to be proud of. What was a country without Wallace, Bruce, and Burns? I find in the untraveled Scotsman of today something still of this feeling. It remains for maturer years and wider knowledge to tell us that every nation has its heroes, its romance, its traditions, and its achievements, and while the true Scotsman will not find reason in after years to lower the estimate he has formed of his own country and of its position, even among the larger nations of the earth, he will find ample reason to raise his opinion of other nations, because they all have much to be proud of, quite enough to stimulate their sons so to act their parts as not to disgrace the land that gave them birth. It was years before I could feel that the new land could be anything but a temporary abode. My heart was in Scotland. I resembled Principal Peterson's little boy, who, when in Canada, in reply to a question, said he liked Canada very well for a visit, but he could never live so far away from the remains of Bruce and Wallace. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2. Dunfermline and America. My good Uncle Lauder justly set great value upon recitation in education, and many were the pennies which Dodd and I received for this. In our little frocks or shirts, our sleeves rolled up, paper helmets and blackened faces, with laths for swords, my cousin and myself were kept constantly reciting Norval and Glenalvan, Roderick Dhu and James Fitz, James to our schoolmates, and often to the older people. I remember distinctly that in the celebrated dialogue between Norval and Glenalvan we had some qualms about repeating the phrase, "and false as hell." At first we made a slight cough over the objectionable word, which always created amusement among the spectators. It was a great day for us when my uncle persuaded us that we could say hell without swearing. I am afraid we practiced it very often. I always played the part of Glenalvan, and made a great mouthful of the word. It had for me the wonderful fascination attributed to forbidden fruit. I can well understand the story of Marjorie Fleming, who, being cross one morning when Walter Scott called and asked how she was, answered, "I am very cross this morning, Mr. Scott. I just went to say damn with a swing, but I winna." Thereafter, the expression of the one fearful word was a great point. Ministers could say damnation in the pulpit without sin, and so we too had full range on hell in recitation. Another passage made a deep impression. In the fight between Norval and Glenalvan, Norval says, "When we contend again, our strife is mortal." Using these words in an article written for the North American Review in 1897, my uncle came across them and immediately sat down and wrote me from Dunfermline that he knew where I had found the words. He was the only man living who did. My power to memorize must have been greatly strengthened by the mode of teaching adopted by my uncle. I cannot name a more important means of benefiting young people than encouraging them to commit favorite pieces to memory and recite them often. Anything which pleased me, I could learn with a rapidity which surprised partial friends. I could memorize anything, whether it pleased me or not, but if it did not impress me strongly, it passed away in a few hours. One of the trials of my boy's life at school in Dunfermline was committing to memory two double verses of the Psalms which I had to recite daily. My plan was not to look at the psalm until I had started for school. It was not more than 5 or 6 minutes' slow walk, but I could readily master the task in that time. And, as the psalm was the first lesson, I was prepared and passed through the ordeal successfully. Had I been asked to repeat the psalm 30 minutes afterwards, the attempt would, I fear, have ended in disastrous failure. The first penny I ever earned, or ever received from any person beyond the family circle, was one from my schoolteacher, Mr. Martin, for repeating before the school Burns' poem, Man Was Made to Mourn. In writing this, I am reminded that in later years, dining with Mr. John Morley in London, the conversation turned upon the life of Wordsworth, and Mr. Morley said he had been searching his Burns for the poem To Old Age, so much extolled by him, which he had not been able to find under that title. I had the pleasure of repeating part of it to him. He promptly handed me a second penny. Ah, great as Morley is, he wasn't my schoolteacher. Mr. Martin, the first great man I ever knew. Truly great was he to me, but a hero surely is honest John Morley. In religious matters we were not much hampered. While other boys and girls at school were compelled to learn the shorter catechism, Dodd and I, by some arrangement, the details of which I never clearly understood, were absolved. All of our family connections, Morrison's and Lauder's, were advanced in their theological as in their political views, and had objections to the catechism, I have no doubt. We had not one Orthodox Presbyterian in our family circle. My father, uncle, and aunt Aitken, Uncle Lauder, and also my Uncle Carnegie, had fallen away from the tenets of Calvinism. At a later day, most of them found refuge for a time in the doctrines of Swedenborg. My mother was always reticent upon religious subjects. She never mentioned these to me, nor did she attend church, for she had no servant in those early days, and did all the housework, including cooking our Sunday dinner. A great reader, always, Channing the Unitarian, was in those days her special delight. She was a marvel. During my childhood, the atmosphere around me was in a state of violent disturbance in matters theological as well as political. Along with the most advanced ideas which were being agitated in the political world, the death of privilege, the equality of the citizen, republicanism, I heard many disputations upon theological subjects which the impressionable child drank in to an extent quite unthought of by his elders. I well remember that the stern doctrines of Calvinism lay as a terrible nightmare upon me, but that state of mind was soon over, owing to the influences of which I have spoken. I grew up treasuring within me the fact that my father had risen and left the Presbyterian Church one day when the minister preached the doctrine of infant damnation. This was shortly after I had made my appearance. Father could not stand it, and said, "If that be your religion, and that your God, I seek a better religion and a nobler God." He left the Presbyterian Church, never to return, but he did not cease to attend various other churches. I saw him enter the closet every morning to pray, and that impressed me. He was indeed a saint, and always remained devout. All sects became to him as agencies for good. He had discovered that theologies were many, but religion was one. I was quite satisfied that my father knew better than the minister, who pictured not the Heavenly Father, but the cruel avenger of the Old Testament, an eternal torturer, as Andrew D. White ventures to call him in his autobiography. Fortunately, this conception of the unknown is now largely of the past. One of the chief enjoyments of my childhood was the keeping of pigeons and rabbits. I am grateful every time I think of the trouble my father took to build a suitable house for these pets. Our home became headquarters for my young companions. My mother was always looking to home influences as the best means of keeping her two boys in the right path. She used to say that the first step in this direction was to make home pleasant, and there was nothing she and my father would not do to please us and the neighbors' children who centered about us.
My first business venture was securing my companion's services for a season as an employer, the compensation being that the young rabbits, when such came, should be named after them. The Saturday holiday was generally spent by my flock in gathering food for the rabbits. My conscience reproves me today, looking back, when I think of the hard bargain I drove with my young playmates, many of whom were content to gather dandelions and clover for a whole season with me, conditioned upon this unique reward, the poorest return ever made to labor. Alas, what else had I to offer them? Not a penny. I treasure the remembrance of this plan as the earliest evidence of organizing power upon the development of which my material success in life has hung, a success not to be attributed to what I have known or done myself, but to the faculty of knowing and choosing others who did know better than myself. Precious knowledge this for any man to possess. I did not understand steam machinery, but I tried to understand that much more complicated piece of mechanism, man. Stopping at a small Highland inn on our coaching trip in 1898, a gentleman came forward and introduced himself. He was Mr. McIntosh, the great furniture manufacturer of Scotland, a fine character, as I found out afterward. He said he had ventured to make himself known as he was one of the boys who had gathered, and sometimes he feared conveyed, spoil for the rabbits, and had one named after him. It may be imagined how glad I was to meet him, the only one of the rabbit boys I have met in afterlife. I hope to keep his friendship to the last and see him often. As I read this manuscript today, December 1st, 1913, I have a very precious note from him, recalling old times when we were boys together. He has a reply by this time that will warm his heart, as his note did mine. With the introduction and improvement of steam machinery, trade grew worse and worse in Dunfermline for the small manufacturers, and at last a letter was written to my mother's two sisters in Pittsburgh stating that the idea of our going to them was seriously entertained. Not, as I remember hearing my parents say, to benefit their own condition, but for the sake of their two young sons. Satisfactory letters were received in reply. The decision was taken to sell the looms and furniture by auction, and my father's sweet voice sang often to mother, brother, and me, "To the west, to the west, to the land of the free, where the mighty Missouri rolls down to the sea, where a man is a man even though he must toil, and the poorest may gather the fruits of the soil." The proceeds of the sale were most disappointing. The looms brought hardly anything, and the result was that £20 more were needed to enable the family to pay passage to America. Here, let me record an act of friendship performed by a lifelong companion of my mother, who always attracted staunch friends because she was so staunch herself, Mrs. Henderson, by birth Ella Ferguson, the name by which she was known in our family. She boldly ventured to advance the needful £20, my uncles Lauder and Morrison guaranteeing repayment. Uncle Lauder, who also lent his aid and advice, managing all the details for us, and on the 17th day of May, 1848, we left Dunfermline. My father's age was then 43, my mother's 33. I was in my 13th year, my brother Tom in his 5th year, a beautiful white-haired child with lustrous black eyes, who everywhere attracted attention. I had left school forever, with the exception of one winter's night schooling in America, and later a French night teacher for a time, and, strange to say, an elocutionist from whom I learned how to declaim. I could read, write, and cipher, and had begun the study of algebra and of Latin. A letter written to my Uncle Lauder during the voyage, and since returned, shows that I was then a little penman than now. I had wrestled with English grammar, and knew as little of what it was designed to teach as children usually do. I had read little except about Wallace, Bruce, and Burns, but knew many familiar pieces of poetry by heart. I should add to this the fairy tales of childhood, and especially the Arabian Nights, by which I was carried into a new world. I was in dreamland as I devoured those stories. On the morning of the day we started from beloved Dunfermline, in the omnibus that ran upon the coal railroad to Charleston, I remember that I stood with tearful eyes looking out of the window until Dunfermline vanished from view, the last structure to fade being the grand and sacred old abbey. During my first 14 years of absence, my thought was almost daily, as it was that morning, "When shall I see you again?" Few days passed in which I did not see in my mind's eye the talismanic letters on the abbey tower, King Robert the Bruce. All my recollections of childhood, all I knew of fairyland, clustered around the old abbey and its curfew bell, which tolled at 8 o'clock every evening and was a signal for me to run to bed before it stopped. I have referred to that bell in my American Foreign Hand in Britain when passing the abbey, and I may as well quote from it now. As we drove down the Pens, I was standing on the front seat of the coach with Provost Walls when I heard the first toll of the abbey bell, tolled in honor of my mother and myself. My knees sank from under me, the tears came rushing before I knew it, and I turned round to tell the provost that I must give in. For a moment I felt as if I were about to faint. Fortunately, I saw that there was no crowd before us for a little distance. I had time to regain control, and, biting my lips till they actually bled, I murmured to myself, "No matter, keep cool, you must go on." But never can there come to my ears on earth, nor enter so deep into my soul, a sound that shall haunt and subdue me with its sweet, gracious, melting power as that did. By that curfew bell, I had been laid in my little couch to sleep the sleep of childish innocence. Father and mother, sometimes the one, sometimes the other, had told me, as they bent lovingly over me night after night, what that bell said as it tolled. Many good words has that bell spoken to me through their translations. No wrong thing did I do through the day which that voice from all I knew of heaven and the great Father there did not tell me kindly about ere I sank to sleep, speaking the words so plainly that I knew that the power that moved it had seen all and was not angry, never angry, never, but so very, very sorry. Nor is that bell dumb to me today when I hear its voice. It still has its message, and now it sounded to welcome back the exiled mother and son under its precious care again. The world has not within its power to devise, much less to bestow upon us, such rewards as that which the abbey bell gave when it tolled in our honor. But my brother Tom should have been there also. This was the thought that came. He, too, was beginning to know the wonders of that bell ere we were away to the newer land. Rousseau wished to die to the strains of sweet music. Could I choose my accompaniment, I could wish to pass into the dim beyond with the tolling of the abbey bell sounding in my ears, telling me of the race that had been run, and calling me, as it had called the little white-haired child for the last time, to sleep. I have had many letters from readers speaking of this passage in my book, some of the writers going so far as to say that tears fell as they read. It came from the heart, and perhaps that is why it reached the hearts of others. We were rowed over in a small boat to the Edinburgh steamer in the Firth of Forth. As I was about to be taken from the small boat to the steamer, I rushed to Uncle Lauder and clung round his neck, crying out, "I cannot leave you! I cannot leave you!" I was torn from him by a kind sailor who lifted me up on the deck of the steamer. Upon my return visit to Dunfermline, this dear old fellow, when he came to see me, told me it was the saddest parting he had ever witnessed. We sailed from the Broomielaw of Glasgow in the 800-ton sailing ship Wiscasset. During the 7 weeks of the voyage, I came to know the sailors quite well, learned the names of the ropes, and was able to direct the passengers to answer the call of the boatswain. For the ship being undermanned, the aid of the passengers was urgently required. In consequence, I was invited by the sailors to participate on Sundays in the one delicacy of the sailors' mess, plum duff. I left the ship with sincere regret. The arrival at New York was bewildering. I had been taken to see the Queen at Edinburgh, but that was the extent of my travels before emigrating. Glasgow we had not time to see before we sailed. New York was the first great hive of human industry among the inhabitants of which I had mingled, and the bustle and excitement of it overwhelmed me. The incident of our stay in New York which impressed me most occurred while I was walking through Bowling Green at Castle Garden. I was caught up in the arms of one of the Wiscasset sailors, Robert Berryman, who was decked out in regular jack-ashore fashion, with blue jacket and white trousers. I thought him the most beautiful man I had ever seen. He took me to a refreshment stand and ordered a glass of sarsaparilla for me, which I drank with as much relish as if it were the nectar of the gods. To this day, nothing that I have ever seen of the kind rivals the image which remains in my mind of the gorgeousness of the highly ornamented brass vessel out of which that nectar came foaming. Often, as I have passed the identical spot, I see standing there the old woman's sarsaparilla stand, and I marvel what became of the dear old sailor. I have tried to trace him, but in vain, hoping that if found, he might be enjoying a ripe old age, and that it might be in my power to add to the pleasure of his declining years. He was my ideal Tom Bowling, and when that fine old song is sung, I always see as the form of manly beauty my dear old friend Berryman. Alas, ere this he's gone aloft. Well, by his kindness on the voyage, he made one boy his devoted friend and admirer. We knew only Mr. and Mrs. Sloan in New York, parents of the well-known John, Willie, and Henry Sloan. Mrs. Sloan, Euphemia Douglas, was my mother's companion in childhood in Dunfermline. Mr. Sloan and my father had been fellow weavers. We called upon him and were warmly welcomed. It was a genuine pleasure when Willie, his son, bought ground from me in 1900 opposite our New York residence for his two married daughters, so that our children of the third generation became playmates as our mothers were in Scotland. My father was induced by immigration agents in New York to take the Erie Canal by way of Buffalo and Lake Erie to Cleveland, and thence down the canal to Beaver, a journey which then lasted 3 weeks, and is made today by rail in 10 hours. There was no railway communication then with Pittsburgh, nor indeed with any western town. The Erie Railway was under construction, and we saw gangs of men at work upon it as we traveled. Nothing comes amiss to youth, and I look back upon my 3 weeks as a passenger upon the canal boat with unalloyed pleasure. All that was disagreeable in my experience has long since faded from recollection, excepting the night we were compelled to remain upon the wharf boat at Beaver, waiting for the steamboat to take us up the Ohio to Pittsburgh. This was our first introduction to the mosquito in all its ferocity. My mother suffered so severely that in the morning she could hardly see. We were all frightful sights, but I do not remember that even the stinging misery of that night kept me from sleeping soundly. I could always sleep, never knowing horrid night, the child of hell. Our friends in Pittsburgh had been anxiously waiting to hear from us, and in their warm and affectionate greeting, all our troubles were forgotten. We took up our residence with them in Allegheny City. A brother of my Uncle Hogan had built a small weaver shop at the back end of a lot in Rebecca Street. This had a second story in which there were two rooms, and it was in these, free of rent, for my Aunt Aiken owned them, that my parents began housekeeping. My uncle soon gave up weaving, and my father took his place, and began making tablecloths, which he had not only to weave, but afterwards, acting as his own merchant, to travel and sell, as no dealers could be found to take them in quantity. He was compelled to market them himself, selling from door to door. The returns were meager in the extreme. As usual, my mother came to the rescue. There was no keeping her down. In her youth, she had learned to bind shoes in her father's business for pin money, and the skill then acquired was now turned to account for the benefit of the family. Mr. Phipps, father of my friend and partner, Mr. Henry Phipps, was, like my grandfather, a master shoemaker. He was our neighbor in Allegheny City. Work was obtained from him, and in addition to attending to her household duties, for, of course, we had no servant, this wonderful woman, my mother, earned $4 a week by binding shoes. Midnight would often find her at work. In the intervals during the day and evening, when household cares would permit, and my young brother sat at her knee threading needles and waxing the thread for her, she recited to him, as she had to me, the gems of Scottish minstrelsy, which she seemed to have by heart, or told him tales which failed not to contain a moral. This is where the children of honest poverty have the most precious of all advantages over those of wealth. The mother, nurse, cook, governess, teacher, saint, all in one. The father, exemplar, guide, counselor, and friend. Thus were my brother and I brought up. What has the child of millionaire or nobleman that counts compared to such a heritage? My mother was a busy woman, but all her work did not prevent her neighbors from soon recognizing her as a wise and kindly woman whom they could call upon for counsel or help in times of trouble. Many have told me what my mother did for them. So it was in after years, wherever we resided, rich and poor came to her with their trials and found good counsel. She towered among her neighbors wherever she went. End of chapter 2. Chapter 3. Pittsburgh and Work. The great question now was what could be found for me to do. I had just completed my 13th year, and I fairly panted to get to work that I might help the family to a start in the new land. The prospect of want had become to me a frightful nightmare. My thoughts at this period centered in the determination that we should make and save enough of money to produce $300 a year, $25 monthly, which I figured was the sum required to keep us without being dependent upon others. Every necessary thing was very cheap in those days. The brother of my Uncle Hogan would often ask what my parents meant to do with me, and one day there occurred the most tragic of all scenes I have ever witnessed. Never can I forget it. He said, with the kindest intentions in the world, to my mother that I was a likely boy and apt to learn, and he believed that if a basket were fitted out for me with knick-knacks to sell, I could peddle them around the wharves and make quite a considerable sum. I never knew what an enraged woman meant till then. My mother was sitting sewing at the moment, but she sprang to her feet with outstretched hands and shook them in his face. "What? My son, a peddler? And go among rough men upon the wharves? I would rather throw him into the Allegheny River." "Leave me," she cried, pointing to the door, and Mr. Hogan went. She stood a tragic queen. The next moment she had broken down, but only for a few moments did tears fall and sobs come. Then she took her two boys in her arms and told us not to mind her foolishness. There were many things in the world for us to do, and we could be useful men, honored and respected, if we always did what was right. It was a repetition of Helen McGregor in her reply to Osbaldistone, in which she threatened to have her prisoners chopped into as many pieces as there are checks in the tartan. But the reason for the outburst was different. It was not because the occupation suggested was peaceful labor, for we were taught that idleness was disgraceful, but because the suggested occupation was somewhat vagrant in character and not entirely respectable in her eyes. Better death. Yes, mother would have taken her two boys, one under each arm, and perished with them, rather than they should mingle with low company in their extreme youth. As I look back upon the early struggles, this can be said. There was not a prouder family in the land. A keen sense of honor, independence, self-respect pervaded the household. Walter Scott said of Burns that he had the most extraordinary eye he ever saw in a human being. I can say as much for my mother. As Burns has it, her eye even turned on empty space, beamed keen with honor. Anything low, mean, deceitful, shifty, coarse, underhand, or gossipy was foreign to that heroic soul. Tom and I could not help growing up respectable characters, having such a mother and such a father. For the father, too, was one of nature's noblemen, beloved by all, a saint. Soon after this incident, my father found it necessary to give up hand-loom weaving and to enter the cotton factory of Mr. Blackstock, an old Scotsman in Allegheny City, where we lived. In this factory, he also obtained for me a position as bobbin boy, and my first work was done there at $1.20 per week. It was a hard life. In the winter, father and I had to rise and breakfast in the darkness, reach the factory before it was daylight, and, with a short interval for lunch, work till after dark. The hours hung heavily upon me, and in the work itself I took no pleasure. But the cloud had a silver lining, as it gave me the feeling that I was doing something for my world, our family. I have made millions since, but none of those millions gave me such happiness as my first week's earnings. I was now a helper of the family, a breadwinner, and no longer a total charge upon my parents. Often had I heard my father's beautiful singing of the Bodhi Rose, and often I longed to fulfill the last lines of the verse. When Alec, Jock, and Janetti are up and got their lair, they'll serve to gar the Bodhi Row and lichten our care. I was going to make our tiny craft skim. It should be noted here that Alec, Jock, and Janetti were first to get their education. Scotland was the first country that required all parents, high or low, to educate their children, and established the parish public schools. Soon after this, Mr. John Hay, a fellow Scotch manufacturer of bobbins in Allegheny City, needed a boy, and asked whether I would not go into his service. I went, and received $2 per week. But at first, the work was even more irksome than the factory. I had to run a small steam engine and to fire the boiler in the cellar of the bobbin factory. It was too much for me. I found myself night after night sitting up in bed trying the steam gauges, fearing at one time that the steam was too low and that the workers above would complain that they had not power enough, and at another time that the steam was too high and that the boiler might burst. But all this it was a matter of honor to conceal from my parents. They had their own troubles, and bore them. I must play the man, and bear mine. My hopes were high, and I looked every day for some change to take place. What it was to be, I knew not, but that it would come, I felt certain if I kept on. Besides, at this date, I was not beyond asking myself what Wallace would have done, and what a Scotsman ought to do. Of one thing I was sure, he ought never to give up. One day the chance came. Mr. Hay had to make out some bills. He had no clerk, and was himself a poor penman. He asked me what kind of hand I could write, and gave me some writing to do. The result pleased him, and he found it convenient thereafter to let me make out his bills. I was also good at figures, and he soon found it to be to his interest. And besides, dear old man, I believe he was moved by good feeling toward the white-haired boy, for he had a kind heart and was Scotch, and wished to relieve me from the engine, to put me at other things less objectionable except in one feature. It now became my duty to bathe the newly made spools in vats of oil. Fortunately, there was a room reserved for this purpose, and I was alone, but not all the resolution I could muster, nor all the indignation I felt at my own weakness, prevented my stomach from behaving in a most perverse way. I never succeeded in overcoming the nausea produced by the smell of the oil. Even Wallace and Bruce proved impotent here. But if I had to lose breakfast, or dinner, I had all the better appetite for supper, and the allotted work was done. A real disciple of Wallace or Bruce could not give up. He would die first. My service with Mr. Hay was a distinct advance upon the cotton factory, and I also made the acquaintance of an employer who was very kind to me. Mr. Hay kept his books in single entry, and I was able to handle them for him. But hearing that all great firms kept their books in double entry, and after talking over the matter with my companions, John Phipps, Thomas N. Miller, and William Cowley, we all determined to attend night school during the winter and learn the larger system. So the four of us went to a Mr. Williams in Pittsburgh and learned double-entry bookkeeping. One evening, early in 1850, when I returned home from work, I was told that Mr. David Brooks, manager of the telegraph office, had asked my Uncle Hogan if he knew where a good boy could be found to act as messenger. Mr. Brooks and my uncle were enthusiastic draught players, and it was over a game of draughts that this important inquiry was made. Upon such trifles do the most momentous consequences hang. A word.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.